Good evening, everyone. So today's session is going to be about terminologies in labor. Can we share the screen, the slides? So the terminologies which we're going to cover here are lie, presentation, position, and attitude. So these are the terminologies which we should know before we take up the patient for labor to know what is the exact position of the baby. So the first one is lie. So lie is the relationship of the, okay, can we have the first slide? Yeah. So the lie is the relationship of the long axis of the fetus to the long axis of the centralized uterus or maternal spine. And although there are four types of lie, longitudinal, transverse, oblique, and unstable, 99.5% of the patients are going to have a longitudinal lie. So if the relationship of the fetus is parallel to the maternal axis, then the lie is called longitudinal. Okay. And if the relationship of the long axis of the fetus is perpendicular to the maternal axis, it is transverse. If it is at 45 degrees to the maternal axis, it is oblique. And unstable lie is seen in those fetuses where there is excess lie curve. And every time you examine once in 2 weeks, the lie keeps changing. But finally, this lie stabilizes. So the commonest lie here is the longitudinal lie. If you look at the pictures A and B, B looks like it is an oblique lie. But it is also a case of longitudinal lie. This is because of the dextrorotation of the uterus that the fetus looks that it is in an oblique lie. So what you have to remember before examination of the uterus, of obstetric examination, is to always correct dextrorotation of the uterus. Uterus has a tendency to deviate towards the right. So before you do any kind of examination, obstetric examination, correct the dextrorotation. So if you examine the patient B in the way the uterus is lying, you will feel that it is oblique lie. But if you correct dextrorotation and then examine, then you will realize that actually it is longitudinal lie. So that is why the definition is relationship of long axis of fetus to long axis of centralized uterus. So in B, the uterus is not centralized, it is deviated. So through the long axis of, and you centralize the uterus, then both the fetus and the uterus and the maternal spine are parallel to each other. So that will be longitudinal lie. Okay, next slide, please. Presentation. Presentation is the part of the fetus which occupies the lower pole of the uterus. Here again, there are four types. If it is head which is occupying the lower pole, it is cephalic. If it is the podalic or the breech, it is breech or podalic presentation. If the baby is in transverse lie, then it is shoulder. And in certain cases, it will be compound presentation where more than one structure. With head, there can be a hand by the side of the head. Or just aside the head, there might be cord. Or with the breech, there might be some amount of cord or breech with feet. So all that comes with compound presentation. The incidence of breech presentation is about 3%. And shoulder is about 0.5%. Here again, the major presentation being cephalic presentation, which is 96.5%. Does anybody know why cephalic is more common presentation? You can type the answers if you know why cephalic is the common presentation. Okay. Now, how do you diagnose lie of the fetus? That is by doing your Leopold's maneuvers and by inspecting. Yeah, correct. So by head weight, gravity, head is heavy. That's why it settles down. And gravity makes the head settle down. Any other reason why cephalic is a common presentation other than gravity and head being heavy? Yeah, heavy weight, gravitational. There is one more reason why head comes and occupies the lower pole of the uterus. Yes, shape of the uterus. This is called adaptation. Adaptation is when, because the breech is much bigger, so it accommodates in the broader fundus of the uterus. And head is smaller, the circumference of the head is smaller, so it accommodates itself in the lower pole. The uterus is piriform shaped. Okay, so broader at the top of the fundus and it is narrower at the bottom. So the smaller circumference of the head better adapts to the lower pole of the uterus. How do you diagnose presentation? Which Leopold maneuver do we use? Do you know which Leopold maneuver we are using? Three, not four, three. This is a maneuver. Can you see me? Am I visible? My hand is seen. So this is the first pelvic grip. Okay. The first pelvic grip will tell you what is occupying the lower pole of the uterus. If you feel a ballottable head, then you confirm that the presentation is cephalic. Next slide, please. Presenting part. Now, presentation and presenting part sometimes are used synonymously in labor, but presenting part is more specific than a presentation. It is a part of a presentation which overlies the internal os and can be felt during vaginal examination. So when you, if you do a vaginal examination and you go through the cervix, the part of the presentation which you feel is the presenting part. Okay. As I told you, in cephalic presentation, there are three presenting parts, depending upon how flexed or deflexed or extended the head is. So when there is complete flexion or even moderate flexion, the presenting part is going to be vertex. Okay. When it is in incomplete flexion or partial deflexion, it is the bro which is felt. And when it is fully extended head, then what you see is the face presentation. Okay. So in cephalic presentation, we have three presenting parts, which are vertex, bro, and face. These are nothing but the three the areas of the skull, which I explained in the last class. So the areas of the skull are going to be the presenting parts. So this is the part which you feel when you do a vaginal examination. Presentation is the part of the baby which you feel when you do your first pelvic grip. Okay. Next slide, please. So in breech presentation, the presenting part depends upon how flexed or extended the baby's legs are. So if you see the first picture, there is extension at the level of the knee joints. This is a frank breech. So if you do a PV examination in the first picture, your presenting part is going to be only buttocks and genitalia. Okay, so the presenting part is buttocks and genitalia. In the second picture, there is flexion at the level of the knee joint. So in this case, if you do a PV examination, you will feel the buttocks, the genitalia, and also the feet. Okay, and the last picture is of a footling breech where there is extension at the level of the hip and the knee joint. So when you do a PV examination, you will feel the foot. So the presenting part, there are three presenting parts in breech, and there are three presenting parts even in cephalic presentation. Okay, next slide. So denominator, now a lot of people get confused about presenting part and denominator. So you have to remember is presenting part is the part of the baby overlying the os of the cervix. And whereas denominator is the part of the baby which comes in relation to the pelvis. Okay. So denominator is an arbitrary bony fixed point on the presenting part, which comes in relation with the quadrants of the maternal pelvis. Okay. There are different denominators for different. So in a longitudinalized cephalic presentation, if it is vertex presenting, that is when you do PV examination, you're feeling vertex, then the occiput will be touching the pelvic brim. Okay. So you tell that the position of the baby depending upon the relationship of the occiput to the quadrant of the pelvis. So the denominator becomes the occiput. If face is presenting, the bony prominence of the baby is the mentum. Okay. So the mentum, you describe what is the position of the baby in the pelvis by telling the relationship between the mentum and the various quadrants of the pelvis. For bro, it is frontal eminence. There is no mechanism of labor for bro, but still, if you want to say in which position the bro is lying, you can take frontal eminence as the denominator. In breech, it is the bone which we consider as sacrum. Okay. We say we tell sacrum is either in the left or right of the pelvis, and whether it is anterior or posterior, that's how we tell what is the position of the breech baby. For shoulder, it is the acromion. Okay. Next slide. Okay. Attitude of the fetus is a relationship of different parts of the fetus to one another. The commonest attitude is figure A, which is universal flexion, that is flexion at all joints. If you see the baby's back, spine is become convex, it is fully curved. The head is fully flexed, the chin is touching the chest. The arms are folded in front of the chest, and there is flexion at every joint, wrist joint, elbow joint, shoulder joint, and even at the hip, knee and ankle joint. So this is commonly called the fetal position or the position of universal flexion. This is the commonest position. But sometimes in cephalic presentation, depending upon deflection, although the body will be in flexion, the head might go into deflection, which is less common, like in this where the occipitofrontal diameter is presenting in figure B, and bro presentation, which is still cephalic presentation, but it has gone into deflection. And extreme deflection as in, like complete extension as in face, where the body is slightly also going into deflection. Can you see now in face that the back of the baby is not as curved as the first picture? The back is straightening out, and so is the head. The head, the occiput is touching the back of the fetus, so it has gone into extension. So the commonest is the first picture, which we call as fetal position or the position of universal flexion, where there is flexion at all joints. So the common attitude of the fetus, you should remember, is universal flexion. Next slide, please. So this is what I was telling, position, why you need to know about the denominator. So your denominator is your landmark on the baby, which you tell how it is related to various quadrants of the pelvis, okay? So there are total of 8 positions, out of which direct occipital anterior, where the occiput is facing directly to the pubic symphysis, and direct occipital posterior is very rare. Which is the commonest position among all these? So we have left occipital transverse, where the it is transverse. Yes, left occipital transverse is the commonest. Next commonest is, after left occipital transverse, no, it is right occipital transverse. The transverse positions are more commoner than occipital anterior position. Okay. So the first common position will be where the sagittal suture is in the transverse diameter, left occipital transverse. The next common position is right occipital transverse. So you should know which is the left side and the right side of the maternal pelvis. As I showed you in pelvis, you're holding the pelvis as if it is your pelvis. But now this pelvis, we should imagine the patient sleeping down and you doing a PV examination. So you should imagine which is the left side and the right side of the woman. Okay. So in the left side of the pelvis, if the occiput, if the baby's back is to the left side, then it becomes left positions. If the baby's back is to the right side, it becomes right positions. Okay. If the occiput, the posterior pontonella, the occiput is with the sagittal suture in midline, it becomes left occipital transfer. If the occiput is facing towards the iliopubic eminence, it is left occipital anterior. If the occiput is facing backwards towards the sacroiliac joint, it becomes posterior position. Okay, so this is how you tell the positions of the fetus. Yes, next slide. Okay, so before going for labor and delivery, I will demonstrate with dummy and fetal skull the different definitions which I told you. Okay, can we stop the slide share? Okay. So I need you to tell me if you can see me full screen. Can you see me full screen? Yeah. Okay. So the first definition is lie, which is the relationship of the long axis of the fetus to the long axis of the maternal spine. So this is longitudinal lie. Okay. So the baby can be like this, or any position, but it has to be parallel to the spine, maternal spine. So this is longitudinal lie. For the pelvis, this is longitudinal lie. This is also longitudinal lie. Okay. If you show longitudinal lie like this also is okay. So longitudinal lie can be either cephalic or breech. Okay. Depending upon how the position. So only thing is the long axis of the fetus should be parallel to the centralized uterus or the maternal spine. So this is longitudinal lie. So transverse lie is going to be like this, where the fetus is perpendicular to the maternal spine. It can be in any position, dorso posterior, dorso superior, dorso inferior, or any position. Only thing is the fetus has to be perpendicular to the maternal spine. So this is transverse lie. Again comes oblique lie, where there is a 45 degree angle between the maternal spine and the fetus. This is oblique lie. Okay, this is also oblique lie. Okay, it can either happen in breech or happen in cephalic. Okay, so the only thing is long axis should be at a 45 degree angle. It can be like this. It can be like this. So these are the different lines. Longitudinal, longitudinal, transverse, oblique. The other one is unstable line. Next, coming to the presentation. So in presentation, if the head is occupying the lower pole of the uterus, it is cephalic presentation. It does not matter whether it is flexed or extended. Okay. It doesn't matter if it is vertex, bro, or face. Okay. The only point here is the head is occupying the lower pole of the uterus. The head can be in any stage of flexion or deflection. To say it is a cephalic presentation, the head should occupy the lower pole of the uterus, and you can diagnose this by your first pelvic grip. Okay. So this is how you diagnose the cephalic presentation. Next, coming to the presenting part. Okay. So the presenting part is the part of the baby which you feel when you do a vaginal examination. Okay. So when you do a vaginal examination, the part of the fetus which you feel is the presenting part. So in a well-flexed head, the head is well flexed and patient is lying down, it's a well flexed head, and you do PV, this part, if you feel, this is nothing but the area of the vertex. So when you do a PV, you feel this part, it is vertex. So this is a well flexed head. Now it is going into deflection. You feel the anterior contralinear and you feel the bro when you do PV. This is the presenting part, is bro, and then it becomes the face with complete extension. So depending upon how flexed, deflexed or extended the head is, the presenting part in cephalic presentation itself changes from vertex, bro, to face, depending upon the flexion and extension of the head. Okay, so the presenting part depends upon how flexed or extended the baby's head is. So you should imagine the baby touching the chin, touching the chest, which is flexed, then it is going to be vertex, which you're going to feel. The occiput touching the back, the extension, what you're going to feel when you do PV? The baby's face. So presenting part is the part of the baby which you're feeling when you do a PV examination through the dural os. Okay. Now coming to breech, the presenting part, it depends upon how flexed or deflexed it is. Now this is a frank breech where the legs are extended. There is no flexion at the knee joint. So when you do a PV examination for this patient, you're going to feel the buttocks and the genitalia. So the presenting part of the buttocks and the genitalia. Now, if it is a complete breech where there is flexion at every point, you're going to feel even the feet alongside the buttocks and the genitalia. The presenting part here becomes the buttocks, the genitalia and the feet. Okay. There are some babies which are very premature and they'll be standing like this. Okay. One head, one leg might be flexed, other leg is like this, and the baby is like lying down like this. So you will feel only the foot of the baby. This is called foot limb presenting part. Okay. So in breech, you have frank, complete, and foot limb, where there is extension even at the hip joint and the knee joint. Foot limb, flexion at the hip joint, extension at the knee joint, frank, flexion at both joints, complete. Okay. So this is presenting part. Now coming to denominator. So which part of the fetus comes in relation to the pelvis is denominator. So usually when we're doing PV, we are feeling vertex. So do not say denominator is vertex. We are more interested in what is coming in relation to the pelvis. So the denominator is the occiput. Okay. So for vertex presentation, the denominator is occiput. In face presentation, we are feeling the face, and the chin of the baby comes in relation to the pelvis. So we tell where the, how the baby is lying, depending upon where the chin is pointing in the pelvis. So the denominator becomes the mentum. Okay. In bro, we talk about the frontal eminence, where it is coming in relation to the pelvis. Okay. In breech, the bone which we are interested in is the sacrum. Depending upon where the sacrum is facing in the pelvis, we can tell you what the position of the baby is. So the denominator is the sacrum. Okay. And for shoulder presentation, the denominator is this acromion. Okay. Left side acromion, right side. And also we talk about the position of the back in shoulder presentation. So in a vertex, in a vertex presentation, it is occiput. Bro presentation, it is the frontal eminence. Face presentation becomes the mentum. Okay, so these are the difference. So when you have fetal skull and pelvis station, they might also tell you to demonstrate how you will hold the skull in left occipital anterior. How will you hold the dummy? So those are the positions. So I will just show you the positions once. Okay. So this is the left and this is the right part of the pelvis. Okay. This is the occiput. So the occiput is in the left part of the pelvis. Okay. So here the sagittal suture is in the midline, the transverse axis. This is left occipital transverse. The baby is rotated like this and the occiput is facing the iliopubic eminence part of the pelvic brim. I told you this part is called as the iliopubic eminence. If the occiput is touching that, it is left occipital anterior. When you're showing vertex presentation, you should show like this. It is a flexed. Do not hold like this. This is military attitude. This shows bro presentation. So whenever you're showing vertex, you should flex. You should flex the head. So this is left occipital anterior. Occipital anterior, where the occiput is facing the pubic symphysis. Now the baby has come to the right side. This is right occipital anterior, right occipital transverse. The occiput going towards the right sacroiliac joint, right occipital posterior. The occiput directly against the sacral promontory, occipital posterior. And this position is occiput against the left sacroiliac joint, left occipital posterior, left occipital transverse. The commonest position is like this. The left side of the maternal pelvis, the occiput is in the, with the sagittal suture in the transverse. This is left occipital transverse. The next common position is like this. So this is how you're supposed to hold the skull, I told you. Okay. And this is how you show left occipital transverse, left occipital anterior. I'll show you with a dummy. Imagine a pelvis. I cannot hold a pelvis and show you. So this is the back of the baby. The occiput and the back in a well-flexed head will be in the same position. Okay. So this is left and this is right. So this position of the baby is, what is this position of the baby if it is like this? Anybody? So if the baby is like this in the pelvis with the sagittal suture in the transverse diameter, yeah. So this is left occipital transverse. This is going to become the back and the occiput are facing the left iliopubic eminence. Left occipital anterior, occipital anterior, right occipital anterior, right occipital transverse, right occipital posterior, back and occiput same side, direct occipital posterior, okay, left occipital posterior. Again, we are coming back to occipital transverse. So you should remember that back and the occiput should be on the same side. Okay. So when you're saying left occipital transverse means shoulders will be in the AP diameter. Okay. The sagittal suture goes into the transverse diameter of the pelvis in pelvic inlet. So the occiput is in the transverse plane, back and occiput. So this is left occipital transverse position. Okay. Which is similar to when you hold the fetus like this. So this is left occipital transverse, left occipital anterior, occipital anterior. Okay, so this is what the position is. So these are the positions in vertex presentation. Okay, well flexed head where the suboccipital brigmatic or the suboccipital frontal diameters are presenting. Okay, bro is not that important for you. They will not ask you how to show positions in bro. The next position which they might ask you is face. The positions in face. Okay. Now face is a deflexed or extended head. So usually a face comes from a deflexed head. So this is a well-flexed head. This is a extended head. Okay. So a deflexed head is somewhat like this. So this deflexed head is a unstable position. So with good uterine contractions, either the head should flex or either the head should extend. Okay, so the commonest deflexed position is right occipital posterior. Okay, you have to remember that the commonest deflexed position in a well flexed position, the commonest position of the head is going to be right left occipital transverse, left occipital anterior. Okay, But in a deflexed head, the commonest position is going to be right occipital posterior. So in this position, the head, because it is unstable and deflexed, it extends and it becomes face. Okay, so if anybody tells you to show face position, you start from right occipital posterior position, then you start extending the head and make it face. So this becomes your first position of face, which is left mento anterior towards the left iliopubic eminence. Okay, left mento anterior, mento anterior, right mento anterior. Okay, right mento transverse, right mento posterior, right mento, mento posterior, left mento posterior, left mento transverse, and left mento anterior. So it's very difficult to hold in directly in face presentation. So always start with right occipital posterior, deflex the head, make the chin touch the left iliopubic eminence. That gives you your left mento anterior. So from then you will be able to show all positions. Okay, so start with right occipital posterior, start deflexing, extend it completely. So this position is going to be left mento anterior, okay, where the head is towards the left iliopubic eminence. Okay, so this is the position, which is towards the left iliopubic eminence. Okay, so these are the positions in face. Coming to breech, the positions are sacrum is the denominator. So the positions are left sacro transverse, left sacro anterior, sacro anterior. Okay, then we have right sacro anterior, right sacro transverse, right sacro posterior, sacro posterior, left sacro posterior. Okay, left sacro transverse, we are back to left sacro anterior. So if you have to show positions in breech, you have to locate first the back of the baby, and if you want to show left sacro anterior, you should point the back towards the left iliopubic eminence, and then you can show with rotation all your other positions. So this is left sacro transverse, left sacro anterior, direct sacro anterior. Okay, so these are the different positions. Okay, now attitude, as I told you, is flexion at every joint. So the universal flexion, this is, there will be more curving, convexity of the fetal back, and there will be flexion at every joint. The chin will be touching the chest. This is the commonest attitude, which is called fetal position or universal flexion. Depending upon the flexion and deflection, you will find brow presentation, face presentation. Here the universal flexion is gone because the head starts getting deflexed and then starts getting extended. And when you do PV, you will feel either the face or the brow. Okay, so this is flexion. Can we go back to the slides, please? Okay, so in the next part, I'm going to tell you about the stages of labor and how we are going to manage the stages of labor. Okay, so labor is a series of events. First slide, please. The slide before this. No, before this. Yeah. So labor is a series of events which take place in the genital organs in effort to expel the viable products of conception out of the womb through the vagina into the outer world. So the series of events can be dilatation of the cervix, descent, uterine contraction. So those events which are taking place in the genital organs to expel the products of conception is called labor. So how is this different from the term delivery? Delivery is expulsion or extraction of a viable fetus out of the womb. Okay, it can be expulsion or extraction. So what is the difference between labor and delivery, anybody? Does anybody know what is the difference between labor and delivery? Can there be delivery without labor? Yes, how? So what is the difference between labor and delivery? Cesarean section, yes. So delivery includes both normal vaginal delivery and cesarean section. It is expulsion or extraction where there is no normal delivery, but you're going through the abdominal route and extracting. So that also is a delivery. But labor means the events are happening in the genital organs and the fetus is getting expelled. So delivery is includes labor. Okay, so delivery includes normal labor and also cesarean section, whereas labor is strictly the events which are happening in the genital organs to facilitate a normal delivery. Yeah. Next slide, please. Okay, so the stages of labor, three stages, and some people also see that there are four stages of labor. The first stage, second stage, third stage, and fourth stage of labor. Next slide. Next slide, please. Okay. So the first stage of labor is from the full dilatation, from the onset of good uterine contractions till the full dilatation of cervix. How much centimeters is full dilatation of cervix? Okay. 10 centimeters, yes. So from the onset of good uterine contractions to full dilatation of cervix is the first stage of labor. And the usual duration of how long is first stage of labor in a primi gravida? How long do you think a woman takes to become fully dilated once she starts getting contractions? Yeah, about 8 to 12 hours. It's about 12 hours in a primi gravida and about 6 hours. Yes, 6 hours from the time in a multigravida that contractions start till she becomes fully dilated. Okay. Second stage of labor is from full dilatation of cervix till the expulsion of the baby. Third stage of labor is the delivery of the placenta. The fourth stage of labor is a stage of observation. It's called the golden hour, where we can detect any problems happening like PPH, okay, where we monitor the woman and prevent her from going into some catastrophic hemorrhage. Okay, so what is the event in the first stage? So what is actually happening is the first stage is formation of a birth canal. Okay, so there is the uterus, the cervix, and the vagina. So the end of the first stage, what we want to accomplish is make it into a single canal. The cervix becomes a part of the uterus and the vagina. So it becomes a single canal for the baby to deliver. So that is what is happening in the first stage of labor. Okay, if you see in the last picture, they all become a single canal, the uterus, the cervix, and the vagina. So this is accomplished by dilatation of cervix, effacement of cervix, and full formation of lower uterine segment. Okay, dilatation of cervix is opening up of the cervix. Okay. So when it starts from 0 centimeter, 1, 2, 3, maximum up to 10 centimeters is dilatation of the cervix. Effacement of cervix is shortening of the cervix, when the cervix becomes shorter in length. So it becomes shorter, shorter, gets pulled up, and then becomes a part of the uterus, and formation of lower uterine segment. Okay, there is something called as polarity of the uterus. Okay, the upper part of the uterus contracts and retracts and pushes the baby down. The lower part of the uterus is a receptive segment. It is a passive segment. It relaxes and receives the baby. So there is a formation of a lower uterine segment from the part of the isthmus. Lower uterine segment is a commonly asked question for you, even in theory. What is the clinical significance of the lower uterine segment? This is a segment through which we do the lower segment cesarean section. This is where the bladder is attached very loosely. The peritoneum is attached loosely. And here there is a retraction ring if there is this one. And rupture of uterus takes place through lower uterine segment. If placenta is attached to lower uterine segment, it causes placenta previa. So that is the clinical significance of the lower uterine segment. Now this, again, formation of lower uterine segment is happening because of contraction and retraction of the uterus. What is the difference between contraction and retraction? The two terminologies, anybody? So this contraction and retraction is responsible for effacement of the cervix, dilatation of the cervix, and full formation of the lower uterine segment. So what is contraction and what is retraction? Yes, retraction is irreversible shortening. Okay, so a muscle fiber in contraction means it becomes short and becomes long. There is contraction and relaxation. Okay, retraction is permanent shortening of the muscle fiber. Once it becomes short, it does not go back to the previous long position. Okay, so contraction is temporary, retraction is permanent shortening. Okay, contraction, it contracts, again relaxes, contracts, relaxes. Retraction is permanent shortening. So when the uterus retracts and becomes thicker, as you can see, the upper wall is becoming thicker and thicker, the lower your segment is becoming thinner and thinner. The retraction property is only present in the upper segment of the uterus. The lower segment does not have the property of retraction. Okay, just receptively relaxes. So when this becomes thicker and thicker and retracts, the muscle fibers become shortened, there is less space for the baby in the upper segment, and the baby eventually starts getting pushed down to the lower segment. Now the head pushing, the bag of water all comes down, and they put a pressure on the cervix and try to open up the cervix. That is what is causing dilatation and effacement. So the important thing here is there is a formation of a birth canal, which is happening due to the contraction and retraction of the uterus. And the events leading to that is dilatation and effacement of the cervix and formation of lower uterine segment. So the end of the first stage, the uterine cervix is fully open, and the entire uterus, cervix and vagina form a single canal through which the baby can exit. Yes, next slide, please. So what are the events in second stage? There are two phases in the second stage. They are called propulsive and expulsive. Propulsive phase is from full dilatation of the cervix till the head of the baby reaches the pelvic floor. Okay, so propulsive is dilatation has already happened. The baby is now descending down and down and down, and it is trying to touch the pelvic floor. Expulsive is an voluntary effort by the mother, because when the head touches the pelvic floor, the nerves get stimulated, the Ferguson reflex comes into play, and the woman feels like bearing down. Okay, so the propulsive phase corresponds to the descent of the baby's head up to the level of the pelvic floor, whereas expulsive phase corresponds to the bearing down efforts of the mother. Okay, so that is propulsive and expulsive. So from full dilatation till the baby comes out, we have second stage. The first half of it is descent of the baby to the pelvic floor. Next, the mother feels the pressure on the pelvic floor and tries to expel the fetus. Yes, next slide. So the events in third stage is placental separation, separation of membranes and expulsion of placenta. Okay, so there are two methods of placental separation, which is central separation and marginal separation. In central separation, the margins of the placenta, as you can see in picture A, are attached to the uterus, and the blood starts collecting behind the placenta. Now, because of the weight of the placenta starts increasing, it is pulled down, 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 and it separates. This is central separation. Marginal separation is one part of the placenta starts separating from the uterus and blood starts dripping out. And finally, because of retraction, again, the uterus size becomes smaller, the placenta gets sheared off and separates. So we have central separation and marginal separation. Central is where the central part of the placenta separates and the venous sinuses break open and they start pooling blood behind the placenta. The peripheral part is where the lateral margin of the placenta separates and then the rest of the placenta separates. Which is more common, the central or the marginal peripheral placental implantation, which is separation, which is more common? The central is called Schultz and the lateral is called Matthew Duncan's type of separation of placenta. Normally, how does the placenta separate? Is it central or peripheral? Anybody? It is the peripheral separation of placenta, which is marginal, or peripheral separation of placenta, which is more common than the central separation of placenta. Now, here again, the property of retraction takes place. Now, the uterus, which is at level of the fundus, the ziphy sternum, comes down to the level of below the umbilicus. Now, that is happening because of permanent shortening of muscle fibers. Okay, this is retraction. Again, retraction comes into play in third stage. Because of retraction, the placenta, it is inelastic. The placenta fibers cannot retract. So, they just have to separate from the lesser surface area, which is available to them. Okay, so the large uterus becomes small because of the property of retraction. Placenta has no more surface area to get attached to. It gets sheared off from the placenta. Now, how does the bleeding stop? Now, there are huge uterine sinuses present in the uterus after the placenta has separated. It is the biggest wound a woman can have inside the uterus, wherever the placenta is attached. How does the bleeding stop from the placental site? What stops the bleeding? There are three important mechanisms by which the bleeding stops after the placenta is separated, out of which one is the most important. Yeah, living ligature. Yes, living ligature of the uterus. Okay, so there is interlacing fibers of the myometrium and the blood vessels are going between the interlacing fibers. Here again, important is the property of retraction, permanent shortening of the muscle fibers. They come together and they occlude the saliva. So if there is no retractile property, like if the placenta was implanted not in the upper segment, in the lower segment as a placenta previa, the fibers do not have the capacity of retraction, there is no crisscross arrangement of the fibers, and the placenta previa patient bleeds heavily. Okay, so the major property of the uterus which is helping in controlling bleeding after delivery is the interlacing fibers and the property of retraction. This is called living ligature of the uterus. The other properties which help are thrombosis, like anywhere in the body, bleeding stops by thrombosis. The other property is myotamponade. The anterior and the posterior walls of the uterus get approximated. Okay, there is absolutely no space, and they touch each other and they close the sinus. So there are, these are the three ways by which bleeding stops, you know, after delivery of the placenta. The living ligature, thrombosis, and myotamponade, which is approximation of the anterior and the posterior walls of the uterus. Okay, next slide. So how do you manage normal labor? So the most important term you should remember is maximal observation with minimal active intervention. Many people argue that labor is a natural phenomenon. Even animals deliver even without supervision. So if you let a patient deliver on her own, she's going to deliver. That's what they say. But so there minimal intervention is required, but maximal observation is required. It is a natural phenomenon, yes, but things can go wrong very fast in a laboring patient. So when a laboring patient is brought to a hospital, nobody is expecting anything to go wrong. They don't even consider her as a patient. It is just a woman who has walked in to deliver her baby. It's a happy occasion for the family members. So when things go wrong, the patient and the patient attenders can become extremely violent very fast because they don't consider it like a heart attack patient or an accident patient where they're expecting something to go wrong. Okay, so it is a happy occasion to them. So maximum observation is required. In fraction of seconds, there can be cord prolapse, amniotic fluid embolism, abruption of placenta, okay, vasa previa. So all these emergencies, when they happen, you can lose both the mother and the baby. So although it is a natural process, you need to have maximum observation. Yes, it is normal during the entire gestational period, and suddenly they come to you and things can go wrong, okay, through no fault of yours. So minimal active intervention. So that you have to remember in management of normal labor. What else you have to remember in normal labor is the patient feels extremely anxious and stressed and fearful. So you have to put her fears at rest and give emotional support. The obstetrician might be stressed and she might have 2-3 deliveries waiting and a lot of things happening, and she has to be in a number of places. But what an obstetrician should remember, it is the first time and it is a unique experience for the patient, and she should be supportive to the patients. A lot of emotional support is required in the management of normal labor. Do not scream at the patient. They might behave irrationally because of the pain. So you are supposed to give emotional support. Another thing which is important in the management of normal labor is privacy. Okay. So most normal deliveries when we are conducting in colleges, and because sometimes it's when the input of patients is less, the students want to see normal labor. And there will be 20-30 students crowded when the woman is crowning and delivering, and it's a very private moment for her. So this should not happen. And even when we are including students, when we are doing a normal delivery, we should take the patient's consent, okay, and explain to her. And at the most, 2 or 3 people should be allowed to observe the normal labor. So we should give importance to the privacy of the patient too. So these are the general considerations which we have for the management of normal labor. Next is antiseptics and asepsis. So asepsis of the patient, asepsis by the doctor, they should be followed. The patient should ideally take a bath and wear a gown. She should not be in her clothes, home clothes, and a laundered gown should be worn. She should take a bath, and the vulval area should be trimmed. We don't follow shaving of the vulval area anymore. When there is shaving done, there is increased chance of infection because of folliculitis. So shaving is abandoned in favor of clipping the hairs of the vulva. Okay. And the vulva should be scrubbed with Betadine or Savlon or any solution. So this is asepsis to the level of the patient. Okay. Patient should take a bath, wear a laundered gown, her vulval area should be trimmed and should be scrubbed with Betadine solution. What about the doctor? The doctor, like how a doctor goes to a cesarean section and you follow all your surgical hand cleaning procedures, the doctor has to be scrubbed, okay, before vaginal delivery, even when you want to do a vaginal examination, because if you introduce infection, it can lead to chorioamnitis, infection of the baby, and lots of problems later on, secondary BPH. Okay, so you should be very careful. You should wash your hands like how you're washing in a surgical, like you're going in for a surgery, and then wear sterile gloves. There are a lot of gloves lying around which are unsterile. So the sterile gloves should be worn, and your hands, you should either use a lubricant jelly or Savlon or Cetrimide jelly or Betadine, and then do a vaginal examination. Okay. Vaginal examination should be restricted to a minimum. Okay. The more vaginal examinations you do, you're actually taking the organisms from outside the vagina and introducing into the cervical canal. So you reduce the vaginal examination, the number of vaginal examinations. So when should you do a vaginal examination? The first time the patient comes to you, you should do a vaginal examination. She has come in labor. How do you diagnose labor? Patient is having uterine contractions coming every 5 minutes. Good uterine contractions, but that is not sufficient. Along with that, there has to be cervical effacement dilatation. So you need to do a vaginal examination to confirm. So your vaginal examination should be complete. Once you put your hands into the fingers into the vagina, you should not remove them unless you complete a vaginal examination. Okay. So what are the points which you see? You should remember the Bishop's score. Okay. So what points do you see for vaginal examination is position of the cervix, consistency of the cervix, dilatation, effacement, station of the head, membranes if they are present. If the membranes are ruptured, what is the position of the baby? Is there caput? Is there molding? How is the pelvis? Until you get all this information, do not remove and re-enter. Okay. So your first pelvic examination is most important and should be done by a senior obstetrician because the maximum information can be obtained. So find out about the status of the cervix, status of the membranes, the status of the baby, and the status of the pelvis. Okay. This is your first vaginal examination. So when do you repeat your vaginal examination? Usually when a patient is in active labor, about 2 to 4 hours, every 2 to 4 hours to see if she is dilating, we repeat our vaginal examination. Immediately following rupture of membranes, you need to do vaginal examination. Why should you do vaginal examination after rupture of membranes? Whenever any interference is contemplated also, like you want to put your baby's heart rate is going down, and you want to do something, you want to see what is the dilatation of cervix also, you do a vaginal examination. And to confirm that second stage has begun. So when you do PV and you don't feel the cervix all around, then you can diagnose the second stage by doing a vaginal examination. So starting, you have to do vaginal examination every 2 to 4 hours in active labor following rupture of membranes. When you're planning on intervening because there are some problems with the heartbeat, and to diagnose beginning of second stage. So why do you do a PV examination after rupture of membranes, anybody? It is to diagnose the color of liquor. Okay, whether there is meconium, it is clear, or bloodstain, one. And the second reason why you do following rupture of membranes is to identify cord prolapse. When the membrane ruptures and the head is not well fixed to the cervix, the cord may slide in and the cord may come out. And if the cord gets exposed to the air, there'll be vasoconstriction in the cord vessels causing death of the baby. So following rupture of membranes, you have to do a vaginal examination. So management of first stage, general management is, as I told you, antiseptic dressing, encouragement, emotional support, bubble. Not necessary. If the patient has passed stools, we don't necessarily give an enema, but patients sometimes are more comfortable with an enema. So in a patient in labor, can she move around or not? If the membranes are intact, the patient is allowed to walk. The patient can move around. But once the membranes are ruptured, it is better to lie down in lateral supine position, left lateral position, because then there might be more chance of liquor leakage and cord collapse. So as long as the membranes are intact, the patient can be moved around or take any position that she likes, like sitting or left lateral position. Only supine position is discouraged because it causes venipubic compression. Okay, diet, can we give food during labor? The answer is no. Once a woman goes into active labor, there will be delayed gastric emptying and the food tends to accumulate in the stomach. Okay, so if you want to take the patient for an emergency cesarean section, there will be aspiration of the food contents into the trachea, and this syndrome is called as, anybody? That is why especially obstetric patients, we ask them at least for 6 hours of fasting before we take them for a cesarean section. Okay, the syndrome is called as Mendelsohn syndrome. Okay, Mendelsohn syndrome is aspiration of gastric contents into the respiratory system because we have taken for a cesarean section on a full stomach. It is more common in pregnant women because the lower esophageal sphincter will be more relaxed and there is pressure of the uterus, because of which there is more chance of aspiration in pregnant women. So woman goes into active labor, no solid food. Fluids can be given. Clear fluids can be given. She can have sips of water, or she can have clear fluids like tender coconut water, some juices which are not pulpy. Okay. So clear fluids can be given to up to 2 hours before delivery. So this is about the diet. Next slide. Bladder care. When there is a full bladder, it inhibits uterine contraction. So you should always encourage the patient to go and empty her bladder. When you're inspecting the abdomen itself, you can see the bulge in the supraumbilic area showing you that the bladder is full. So you encourage the patient to pass urine as frequently as possible. Pain relief, there are a lot of pain relief available. Betadine can be used. What we are using now is epidural analgesia, where the patient is absolutely comfortable but still conscious and cooperative. Okay, so pain relief can be given. Assessment of progress of labor by partograph. Okay. And how often should you record the vitals of the patient? So pulse, BP, temperature, urine output and all, every 4 hours at least, you should have a chart. So normally what happens to the pulse rate in a laboring patient? What happens to the pulse and the BP in a patient who is in labor? Increases, yes. Both the pulse increases and BP increases. So you should keep that in mind when you're monitoring the patient. But you should not let the pulse increase to above 100, 110, and it is a sign of early shock and BP for the cases of preeclampsia. You need to monitor the BP. So at least some books say 2 hours, others say every 4 hours. You're supposed to monitor the vitals of the patient in the first stage of labor. How often should you monitor the FHR? FHR should be noted every half an hour in the first stage. Okay. There are two methods by which you can monitor the FHR, which is intermittent auscultation, where you just use a stethoscope and you auscultate for the FHR every half an hour, immediately after a contraction process of for 1 full minute. For 60 seconds, you count the FHR. Okay, after a contraction process, do not try to check the FHR when the patient is having peak of contraction, because that is when the FHR dips. Okay, so FHR should always be checked after the contraction, immediately after contraction passes off for a full minute, not 15 seconds and multiply by 4. Okay, so for a full minute, the FHR has to be monitored. It should be every half an hour in the first stage and every 15 minutes in the second stage. But if your patient is a high risk patient, then in the first stage, every 15 minutes, you're supposed to monitor the FHR, and every 5 minutes in the second stage. Okay, the other method of monitoring FHR is the CTG machine. Now the CTG machine, the cardiotopography machine, gives you a continuous graph of the contractions and the fetal heart rate of the baby. Okay, so it is not that you stand directly in front of the machine and keep staring at it. Okay, the machine graph keeps running, but how often should you check the graph? You should check the graph every half an hour. You come and take a look at the machine, see if there is deceleration, acceleration, and how is the heartbeat. Okay, so this machine continuously will be running. So at least every half an hour in the first stage, you're supposed to come and assess her chart, the CTG graph. Next slide, please. So this is a partograph. A partograph is very important to mark the events happening in labor. It's a composite graphical record of key data during labor, enter against time in a single paper. This is the first half of the partograph. It's actually a full paper. The second half is in the next slide, I will show you. So here, the bottom most, you're supposed to mark the hours. So when do you start plotting the partograph? What are the two phases of labor or first stage of labor? Do you know what are the two phases of labor? I told you about stages, first stage, second stage, third stage, fourth stage, four stages of labor. What are the two phases of labor? Yes, latent phase and active phase. Okay, latent phase is when the patient just starts developing contractions, but there are not much cervical changes. Okay, so you say that up to before 4 centimeters, we consider it to be latent phase. Once the patient reaches 4 centimeters, then you can predict how fast her cervix will dilate. Okay, so once the patient reaches 4 centimeters cervical dilatation, patient is said to be in active phase of labor. So that is when you start plotting your partogram. So if you see in the partogram, the curve, the upward curve of the cervical dilatation, 4 centimeter is 0 hours. So you plot it at zero hours. So from then onwards, you're supposed to start plotting the curve. Okay, so this is a 0 hour starts at 4 centimeters of dilatation of cervix. So cervical dilatation is marked using a X. Okay, so whenever you do a pre-examination, for example, at 0 hours, and below that you can write the time 9 a.m., 10 a.m., 11 a.m. corresponding to the hours. She was at 0 hours, 4 centimeters dilated. After 1 hour, you did a pre-examination. So that time she was 5 centimeters dilated. So you put a X at 5 centimeters. So that is 1 hour after you first saw her. And then about 4.5 hours after that, when you examined, she was fully dilated. So 10 centimeters. So from 9 o'clock to around 12:30, she reached 12 centimeters. So you put an X, you draw all, connect them by a line. So that gives your cervical dilatation curve. Okay. So that is the curve which you draw and which varies from patient to patient. Now there are two lines here, which you can see, which is alert line and action line, which is drawn from before. Okay, which they have taken percentiles of patients on how labor should progress, which is at a rate of about 1 centimeter per hour in a primary and 1.5 centimeter per hour in a multi. So based on that, they have drawn the alert and action lines. So you should see that the curve which you are drawing by connecting the axis should always be to the left of alert line. If that is happening, by taking one look at this, you will feel that, okay, labor is progressing satisfactorily. I don't have to worry. So this gives you a graphical pictorial representation of what is happening with the patient. You don't need to break your head really and calculate. Okay, so one look at this, you will know that, oh, this patient is progressing very well because she is to the left of the alert line. So this is the cervical dilatation line. Now for you have to plot a zero for the descent. Now this descent which they have shown is not in by PV examination station, it is by abdominal examination. Okay, so just above the pubic symphysis, you put your the radial aspect of the index finger and you feel how much of the head is palpable. If only one finger is you're feeling the head, it is 1/5 palpable. If you need two fingers and you're still feeling the head, 3 fingers to feel the head, it is 3/5 palpable. Okay, all 5 fingers you need to feel the head, the head is still feeling upper abdomen, that is 5/5 palpable. Okay, now this patient, 1 hour after your PV examination, when you did an abdominal examination, you could easily feel the head by 3 fingers. So that is 3/5 palpable. Okay. After 2 hours when you did, the head had gone down. So only 2 fingers, you could feel the head. So 2/5 palpable. And about after 5 hours after your initial examination, when you tried to feel the head, you could not feel the head at the level of the abdomen, 0/5 palpable. That means the skull has reached the ischial spine and the head is engaged. Okay. So this is for, so the cervical dilatation curve is a sigmoid curve, which is plotted by doing vaginal examination and by assessing the dilatation by a cervix. One finger is equal to 1.6 centimeter. Okay, so the external loss is allowing one finger inside, means she's 1.6 centimeters dilated. So 2 fingers is going to be about 3 centimeters. 2 fingers you can slightly open up, it is going to be about 4 centimeters. So this is how you assess cervical dilatation. Descent, they don't want to do a repeated PV just for descent. So descent is easily monitored by an abdominal examination by seeing how much fingers above the pubic symphysis you're feeling the baby's head. Okay, 3 finger, 3rd finger is not feeling the head. Only 2 fingers are feeling it is 2/5 palpable. Okay, so this is how you draw the graph. So the descent curve comes down, the dilatation curve goes up. Okay, now the first part of this is the fetal heart rate, which again you mark by a dot. So the first dot, the fetal heart rate was at about 120 beats per minute after half an hour. So every half an hour, you're supposed to plot the fetal heart rate. So this is every half an hour, every line corresponds to half an hour in the fetal heart rate. So after half an hour, it was 130. After the next half an hour, it was 120. Then again, it went up to 140. So then again, join the dots by the line that gives you a fetal heart rate. Again, one look at this, you will feel that, okay, this is between 120 and 160 and it is normal. Okay. If this starts dipping below 120, 110, you will know that something is going wrong with this baby. So partographic is very, very important to monitor to find out what is the maternal well-being and what is the fetal well-being. Okay. Now below the fetal heart rate, you can see amniotic fluid and molding. Okay. There are three abbreviations used for amniotic fluid, which are I, C, M, and B, four. Okay. If you write I in the square, which means the membranes are intact. Okay. You have done PV examination. You're feeling the membranes. They are not ruptured. If you write I at about 9 o'clock, that means at 9 o'clock, the membranes were intact. At 8 o'clock. At 9 o'clock, if you write C, that means membranes are ruptured and the color of lichen is clear. Okay. So at 9 o'clock, the color of lichen was clear. And suddenly at 12 o'clock, if you write M, that means the clear lichen, baby has gone into distress and has become M, meconium stained. Okay. And at some point of time, the color of lichen changes and becomes blood stained. Abruption has started. We're supposed to write B. So I, C, B, and M are the abbreviations which you write in this square, which corresponds to the amniotic fluid. And below that, if molding is present, we write grade 1, grade 2, or grade 3, depending upon how much molding is available. So this is the upper half of the partograph chart. Can you have the second, the lower half? Next slide, please. Yeah. So this is the second half of the entire thing becomes one chart. So it's easy to hand over. So when you just, when you're leaving and somebody else is coming in for a night duty, you just hand over this chart. And they take one look at the chart and don't need to give a lot of explanation. When they see that it is self-explanatory, what time she was, what centimeter dilated, what is the color of lichen, how much her head is descended, what is the heartbeat. Okay, so all that information is available at a single look. So that is the importance of the partograph. So the next one is showing you contractions. Okay, so each square corresponds to one contraction. Okay, so finally, at around 12 o'clock, she had extremely good 5 contractions in 10 minutes. So the number of contractions per 10 minutes it is showing you. And the way of shading tells you how good is the contractions. So how do you assess the contractions in a pregnant woman? Where you should keep your hand to assess the contractions in a pregnant woman? Can you keep it anywhere on the uterus to find out how well it is contracting? Where should you keep your hand to find out about contraction of uterus? It is at the fundus of the uterus. Okay, you place your left hand. Yes, very good. It is over the fundus of the uterus that you place your left hand to find the contraction. Okay, there is something called indentability. You try to push your finger into the uterus and your finger, you cannot indent into the uterus. It has become very hard. Means it is an excellent contraction. It's a very good contraction. If you can indent, it is not such a good contraction. So you keep it and you count for how many seconds the contractions are lasting. Okay. So there are three pictorial representations for this: less than 20 seconds, 20 to 40 seconds, and more than 40 seconds. If it is less than 20 seconds, you're inside the square, you're supposed to put dots like polka dots. Okay. Which is not shown here, but you mark the square with dots. Now this stripes, this oblique stripes, which they have put, it means that each contraction is lasting for, it is between 20 to 40 seconds. Okay. And the last square where they have shaded completely is telling you that each contraction was lasting for more than 40 seconds. Okay. So for a patient to have extremely good contractions, you should have 2 to 3 contractions in 10 minutes, which is lasting for more than 40 seconds. So this should be more than 3 squares, should be colored completely black to tell you that she has set into extreme, very good labor contractions. Okay, so that is telling you about contraction. So less than 20 seconds dots, 20 to 40 seconds stripes, more than 40 seconds completely shade the square. And depending upon how many squares you've shaded, you can come to know how many contractions were there in 10 minutes. Okay, next coming to oxytocin. If you are using oxytocin to induce contractions, you're supposed to say how many units per liter and how many drops per minute you have started contractions. So the next nurse at least knows that how much was started and should I decrease or increase. Any other drugs given, antibiotics, how many IV fluids, injections, a lot of injections we give for dilatation like buscopan, Rotin, epitocin, everything can be written in this part. Okay. Next, coming to the vitals of the patient, pulse is shown by a dot, BP is shown by upward and downward arrow, upward for systolic, downward for diastolic. So every 4 hours also, if you check pulse and BP, it is sufficient. So this patient's BP, initially, it was both times it is about 110 by 70. Okay. The patient's pulse is between 80 beats per minute going high up to about 100 beats per minute. Okay, so this is how the patient's pulse is varying. Temperature, if she's having temperature, like PROM patients, fever patients, you need to monitor temperature also. Just make a note about temperature. If you have sent urine for examination, urine protein acetone volume, you can mark it in the graph. Next slide, please. So this is your partograph, which you should mark in the first stage of labor. Now, management of second stage of labor. Patient is, you have done a PV examination. You cannot feel any part of the cervix around the fetal head. That means the cervix is fully dilated. Again, you are supposed to paint and drape. Paint again, bitted in the vulva and everything. There will be passage of stools, okay, or whatever stool is there. Okay. Make the area aseptic. There are three C's which come in second stage of labor. What are the three C's? What are the three C's we should follow when we are managing second stage of labor? Clean. Three C's. Clean, clean, clean. Yes, clean hands. Yes, clean hands. Next one. Clean surface. Yes. The surface you clean over the vulva also, and also the surface where you keep all your instruments, clean surface. Last C is clean cut. Yeah, very good. The cord you should cut with the sterile scissors, and even the clamping, the instrument should be clean. So clean surface, clean hands, clean cut. Three C's should be followed. Paint and drape the vulva. You come to know that she's in second stage because you have done PV and there is full dilatation of cervix and the patient is really bearing down. She's gone into the expulsive phase. You have now to, you're supposed to now deliver the baby. So delivery of head. So what you have to remember in delivery of the head is maintain as much flexion as possible so that the, try to push the head inside so that the it goes at the level of the anterior fontanelle, so it maintains flexion. And then finally deliver the head by slow extension. Okay, very slow extension. This is called as the Ritgen's maneuver, Ritgen's maneuver, where the left hand is slowly extending the level of the occiput, and the right hand over the chin is slipping off the vagina from over the chin and also giving perineal support. So this is called Ritgen's maneuver of slow extension of the delivery of the head. Okay, now before delivery of the head, you are supposed to give an episiotomy. So when do you give an episiotomy? So when are you supposed to, how do you realize that, okay, now I'm supposed to give an episiotomy? So before you do your Ritgen's maneuver, you're supposed to give an episiotomy. So episiotomy is given when there is crowning of the head. Crowning of the head is when the maximum transverse diameter of the head stretches the vulval outlet. Okay. So this happens a lot of times in second stage of labor. You can see about 5 centimeters of the head at the vulva. But after some time, contraction passes off, the head goes in again. Okay. Then again, with the next contraction, the head comes back and you see 5 centimeters of the head at the vulva. Okay. So when this stops, even with the, when a contraction passes off, the head gets fixed at the vulva and it does not recede back. It is called as crowning, when the greatest transverse diameter of the head stretches the vulval outlet without receding back when the contraction passes off, is called crowning. Okay. So when this happens, you're supposed to give an episiotomy. Delivery of the shoulders is by lateral flexion. You deliver the anterior shoulder first and posterior shoulders, and the rest of the baby is delivered by lateral flexion. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay. So the head is borne by extension. Now, what you have to remember before delivery of shoulders is, when the head is in A and B position, the shoulders have still not come into the anterior posterior diameter. So once the baby's head comes out, immediately do not try to pull on the shoulders because they have not entered into the anterior posterior diameter. Wait for the baby to rotate into restitution and external rotation. So when you see that the head has gone into transverse like this, that means the shoulders will always be perpendicular to the head, and they have gone into anteroposterior. This is when you tug on the sides of the head to pull the shoulders. Next slide. Yeah. So this is how you deliver the shoulders. When the head has gone into the transverse, restitution, external rotation has happened. Shoulders are coming to AP diameter. Pull, deliver anterior shoulders and then deliver the posterior shoulder by lateral flexion. Next slide. So this is episiotomy given at crowning. The common episiotomy which you are following is mediolateral, right mediolateral episiotomy for right-handed people, left mediolateral episiotomy for left-handed. Median, which is the problem, is a midline episiotomy, can extend to the anus and postmetric tear. lateral, where you don't start exactly at the center of the prostate, you start a little away from the midline of the vagina, but it can injure the Bartholin's gland, so not followed. J shape, where you start is midline and then just to curve it off away from the anus. So what episiotomy you are following is mediolateral. Okay, next slide. So they are usually, when they ask you for episiotomy, they ask you which layers you cut. You cut the mucosa, the muscle, and the skin. So again, suture back the mucosa as in B, muscle as in C, and skin in D and E. Okay, so this is how the three layers you're supposed to suture. Next slide. So management of third stage, there was an expectant management and an active management. What should be followed is active management of third stage of labors. These are three steps given by WHO to cause, to reduce the incidence of PPH. Okay. So you're exciting powerful uterine contractions and causing early separation of placenta so that less blood is lost in third stage. Previously, they used to wait for signs of placental separation, abdominal sign, vaginal signs. And when the signs appeared, then you pull. By that time, a lot of blood is lost. So here you're not waiting for signs of placental separation. As soon as the baby is delivered, the first step is administration of 10 units of intramuscular oxytocin. Okay, you're supposed to give an intramuscular injection of oxytocin, 10 units, okay, as soon as the baby is delivered. The second step is delivery of the placenta by controlled cord traction. Control is the left hand over the suprapubic area, which is pushing the uterus up and preventing it from inverting. Traction is the cord traction with the right hand. And once the placenta is out with the right hand, you can massage the uterus, okay, so that it contracts well. There is myotamponade and the bleeding stops. So these are the three steps in the active management of third stage of labor. Okay, as soon as the baby is delivered, give 10 units, that is 2 ampules of intramuscular oxytocin, intragluteal. After that, deliver the placenta by controlled cord traction. Second step. Third step is uterine massage. This completes your management of third stage of labor. Yeah, I think we are done. Next slide. Yeah, thank you. Any doubts, if you would like to ask?
Thank you, ma'am, for this enlightening session.
You're welcome.
We have a few queries for you to answer. Whoever has the questions can ask their questions in the Q&A box. The first question is, ma'am, can you please repeat the most common positions in breech and face?
The common position in face is left mento anterior, okay? Because face comes from right occipital posterior position, becomes in extended, it becomes face. So the most common position is left mento anterior. And for breech also, it is left sacro anterior, okay? So left mento anterior and left sacro anterior are the common positions for face and breech.
How in abdominal examination is occiput at low level, it is well flexed head?
Yeah, this is how it is. Well flexed head. Okay, this is the occiput and this is sensitive. So well flexed head, occiput is gone into the pelvis. Okay, the baby is touching the baby's head is well flexed. So this occiput is the first part which goes in, the sensitive is still above. So when you do an abdominal examination, if you are feeling both occiput and sensiput, that means your head is like this. Okay. So when you do an abdominal examination, feeling both sensiput and occiput means it is not a well-flexed head. If it is like this, the head goes in, occiput goes in first. So occiput becomes lower and you can only feel sensiput on your abdominal examination. Occiput has already become vaginal. So in a well-flexed head, you should only feel the sensiput in abdominal examination. Okay. If you're feeling occiput, that means it is a deflexed head or an extended head. Okay.
Ma'am, how can we check the descent of the head?
There is an abdominal method and there is a vaginal method. Abdominal method is above the pubic symphysis. Imagine that the patient is sleeping abdominally. Left hand radial finger, you feel how much of the head you're feeling. Okay, this is 1/5 part of it. Okay, 2 fingers you're feeling, 2/5 part of it, 3 fingers, 3/5, 4/5, whole thing you're feeling tight. This is a floating head. So this much, these many hands are feeling for the head means it is palpable. Only one hand, only this much part of the head you're feeling, one foot. This is abdominal method. Vaginal method, you first feel for the most prominent part on the lateral part of the pelvis, which is the ischial spine. Okay. Now at the level of the ischial spine, if you feel the head, that is your station. Okay. So you first find out where your ischial spine is when you do a PV examination. And then you pass your fingers and see how much the head is above or below the ischial spine. If it is 1 centimeter above the ischial spine, it is -1, -2, -3, -4, -5. Below ischial spine, 1 centimeter below, +1, +2, +3, +4, +5. When your head has completely entered into the pelvis in engagement, if you do PV examination, it is going to be a zero station. That is, you're exactly at the level of ischial spine, so you're going to feel the fetal skull.
Mm-hmm. Is episiotomy routinely done for everyone?
It is controversial. Episiotomy, there are people who say that it tears much lesser if you do not give an episiotomy. It might not tear as long as have you given episiotomy. But if you do not give an episiotomy, then there may be paraurethral tears. Anterior tears are more common and you do not have a control over the tear. It can extend into the anal sphincter. So preferably in a primary, you need to give an episiotomy. When there is malposition, like occipital posterior position, it's delivering near space to pubis, face presentation, breech presentations. When you have manipulations, you need to give an episiotomy. Big baby, you need to give an episiotomy. And forceps and vacuum, if you're planning to put, you need to give an episiotomy. Other than this, in a multi, third delivery, fourth delivery, you don't need to give an episiotomy.
When is episiotomy sutured back, ma'am? Ma'am, I'm sorry, we can't hear you. Ma'am, you're on mute.
Yeah. The next question was, when is episiotomy sutured back?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So we suture the episiotomy after you deliver the placenta. Third stage is over, placenta is out, and you're finished your active management of third stage of labor. That's when you suture your episiotomy.
What does I stand for in amniotic fluid?
Intact. Membranes are not ruptured. Intact. Okay. I stands for intact.
Diagnosis and management of cervical incompetence.
Cervical incompetence is when she has repeated second trimester abortions. You can diagnose this based on history or an ultrasound. In the first trimester, when you do an ultrasound and the length of the cervix is less than 2.5 centimeters. Or she gives you history of repeated, recurrent, painless second trimester abortions. Okay, so that's when you diagnose cervical incompetence.
Which all positions are an indication for LSCS?
Bro presentation is a definite indication for a cesarean section. In face presentation, the mento posterior, when the chin is facing posteriorly, that is an indication for cesarean section. Breech in a primi gravida is an indication for cesarean section. In a multi, you can try a vaginal delivery. And finally, even in a vertex presentation, if there is cephalopelvic disproportion and the baby's head does not descend, then you can think of a cesarean section. So vertex is not a guarantee that she's going to deliver. Vertex also, if the pelvis is not adequate, you can go for a cesarean section.
Ma'am, now in AMSTL, we should take into account uterine massage or intermittent assessment of uterine tone.
Uterine massage. It is uterine massage. After delivery of the placenta, you are supposed to massage the uterus till it becomes stony hard. Intermittent assessment of uterine tone comes in the management of fourth stage of labor, where every 15 minutes you're checking for the pulse, BP, and the tone of the uterus. That is your intermittent assessment of uterine tone. That is in the fourth stage of labor. Uterine massage for about 5 minutes or till the uterus becomes stony hard. After delivery of the placenta, you're supposed to massage the uterus. Okay, so AMTSL is uterine massage.
Ma'am, how to differentiate what we see in per abdomen in sensiput or occiput, ma'am?
This is PG level question. Even PGs cannot, by abdominal examination, find out syncope or occiput. So you feel for the back, you by your lateral pelvic grip, you feel for the back, okay? And then you feel for the bony prominence on the side of the back, which is going to be always your occiput, okay? If you feel the back one side and you feel that the bony prominence is on the other side, that is going to be your syncope. So by the position of the back, you find out where is the syncope and where is the occiput. If the bony prominence is on the same side as the back, it's going to be the occiput. If the bony prominence is on the other side of the back, if your back is on the left side and you're feeling something bony in the head, prominent part on the other side, that is going to be the syncope. Okay. So in relation to the back, you find out which is the occiput and the syncope.
Ma'am, is uterine massage still included in the AMTSL by WHO?
Yes, it is included. It is the third step. It is included.
Ma'am, in the partograph regarding the membranes, I was for intact. What was the other three?
Clear, C, meconium, M, and blood stain, B.
Okay, ma'am. That's it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Ma'am, thank you so much for this enlightening session on stages of labor and its terminologies. It has been a very insightful and interesting webinar. We all will be eagerly waiting for you on the next session on the 4th of September.
Thanks a lot. Always a pleasure.